listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. On this very edition, this is something a little bit different. I know in the past we've had an episode with Super Executioner and his handler, Mr. P. This time it's, yeah, a little bit different. I did try and contact the monster for a chat. I was very quickly denied or ghosted, but I got Charles Douglas on hand to tell the story of Monstrum and a little bit about his career as well. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you having me.
I'm looking forward to this because first man of few words is Monstrum. Usually it's a very terrifying few words, but you've got his ear. Oh, he's got your ear. You've got his ear. One of the two. So we'll get a little
it
bit.
It switches between. Well, sometimes he's got mine, sometimes I've got his.
We'll get his story in a little bit, but I want to find out a bit more about you first, and then we'll find out more about the monster. Nice. So for those that are listening and watching, just terrifyingly, it's been thunder and lightning for the last 2 hours here in Elgin, and that's just encompassing
quite
what
apt.
The day is going to be. But I think, I don't know if it's that or hell's frozen over, because I have some Murray Cup. You know, I don't want to show off here on the podcast, but anyway, cliche questions. We're going to go for the cliche first.
Go for it.
What made you a fan of professional wrestling? What were your first memories?
So my first sort of memories of how I got into wrestling was, it was around sort of 2006. I'm sort of fairly young at that stage, and it was coming up to Christmas, and all of my friends were getting the SmackDown versus Raw 2006 game, and I genuinely had no idea at that point what wrestling was, but I wanted this because all my friends were getting it. So I've seen to my dad, oh, I'd like this for Christmas, like this, and they're like, do you even know what that is? And I'm like, no, not really. But okay, so go and have a look and see if you like it. So. Okay, it was some Sky clip show thing on the telly. I can't remember exactly what it was, but it was like proof of SmackDown. And I remember the first thing I saw, it was when Batista was champ. And basically, it was some big entrance, and it was just clips of that. So it was like him coming out, all jacked, he had the big gold belt, the pyro. And I'm thinking, oh my God, what is this? This is amazing. Avengers clips was just him bang, bang, and then the big Batista bomb. And I thought, okay, well, I'm hooked. This is me sorted. So then I ended up getting the games. And then that's how I sort of got into it, through the games and stuff like that. After that, I started learning who it was and all that sort of stuff. But I was sort of quite lucky growing up as well, because my dad worked for Sky, which means we got free Sky box office, like live events. So we got them for free because he worked for Sky. So what used to happen is, like, the morning after, like, a pay-per-view, all of my friends would come to my house and would sit and watch it. Yeah, so we were lucky in that regard.
You were the guy. There's always a guy.
Yeah, there's always someone. It just happened to be me that time.
Everyone's got a friend that has Sky. Mine was my mate. I end up inheriting, well, I think I bought all of his VHS tapes. There was, like, 60 of them. Once he grew out of wrestling, I never did. But he was the guy. He'd watch the show on the Monday, I'd get the tape on the Tuesday, return it to him by Thursday, and then that was the cycle once a month. And but no, you're the guy with Sky.
It was one of those, just because my dad so happened to work for Sky, he got like box office live events, got them for free as part of this sort of bonus for working for them, which just so happened at the time, that's how like the pay-per-views and that were doing in the UK. So I just happened to get really lucky with the thing I was into, so.
So it's 2006 then, yes. Which of course is December to December year. But do you remember what your first pay-per-view was?
It'll be the Royal Rumble this year. I honestly don't remember huge amounts about the sort of the Rumble and the actual pay-per-view itself. Because I think, because at that age, my mates would come over and start watching it. And then we'd just start fighting and stuff. Just wrestling between ourselves, because we're like 8, 9 years old. Because that's what 8, 9 year olds do when they start watching wrestling. Mm-hmm. But I sort of started getting more into it in like more in depth around that time. And just, I remember that pay-per-view leading up was just brilliant and stuff like that. And that was around the time of, like, actually, it might have been just after, but I also remember it was around the time of, like, the Battle of the Billionaires and the lead-up to all that, and it's all that sort of stuff. And it's, that was the sort of era where I came into it, and it was really good.
Yeah, I think from my memory, you know, I'm old now, so it's been a while since I've seen those kind of those shows. But WrestleMania 23, I think that was the year for that. No, that's wrong. It's 22. WrestleMania 22. That it was that year. So the year after was Battle of the Billionaires.
There you go. I knew it was around that time. I was about 8, yeah. 9, 10, so it was around that general time. Yeah.
If I'm wrong, I apologize. You can shoot me in the comments. But no, it's a good time to get in, because it's fascinating to find out how people get into wrestling. Because for myself, it was a friend had Sky, and I ended up watching something Undertaker and Kane Inferno match at 8 years old, which terrified me. And then that was it. I was in wrestling figures and then the games. But for yourself and a younger generation now, like pretty much getting into wrestling post 2001, it seems to be just be the video games. Were you always quite a gamer kid?
I was quite enjoyed it, and I think I just got in like I think it was like the PS2 or PS3, I can't remember. I think it was PS3 around that time, because for my birthday's in the August, so I didn't have many games for it. So I was, and because I was like 8 years old, I was getting like two games a year, birthday and Christmas, that's what you got. Mm-hmm. And just one of those, it was like all of my friends were getting this one game, and I thought, well, if everyone else is getting it, it must be good. So that's when I asked for it, and then I ended up leaning on to it, and it was just really, really good.
I was very late to the PS2 to PS3, because, you know, money. And at that point, I was 17, 18, so I had to live on my own and buy my own stuff. So, you know.
Yeah.
Absolute pain.
I've been there, don't worry.
So I was late, and so SmackDown vs. Raw 2007, I had it on the PS2, and I thought, oh, graphics are not going to get any better than this. And then I got SmackDown vs. Raw 2008 when I got my PS3, and I was like, oh my god, what was I doing with my PS2 for so long?
Vivid memories of playing it, and it's so realistic. You look back now and go, what is actually happening here? I can't tell.
I don't remember the ad for 2K15 with it was John Cena and Randy Orton face to face on the PS4. And folk were just going absolutely insane. All the muscle ripples and all that kind of stuff.
You can see the sweat and all that, and
Oh man! And then you go back and play that now, and it looks old in comparison to nowadays.
Exactly.
But you know, speak about games and their graphics. TNA still wins. It's still the best one. TNA wrestling.
Yeah, TNA.
Terrible game. Fantastic graphics.
Yeah, the graphics are great. It's just, I remember playing it and being like, this looks great, but feels weird.
Yeah. I never finished it.
No, I don't think I ever did it. I think I always got stuck in like Homicide or something like that. I just couldn't beat him in that story mode.
Yeah, I got Triple Threat with James Storm or Kevin Nash or something. And I was like, nah, I'm done. I keep meaning to get it again, but just time never happens to be on my side. But anyway, so from that point onwards, Batista's your guy then.
Yeah, Batista was my big guy.
That's your one. Is there anyone else that kind of popped in to say hello as part of your stable of guys?
As I sort of got into that era, it was all the big guys are in there. So it was like John Cena, Triple H. I remember hating with an absolute passion, I hated Edge. And like now looking as I know what happens, like, oh, I was meant to hate him. But it was just like, I used to get so angry when I saw him on screen and stuff like that. And I don't know why, but it's one of the first episodes of Raw I watched, and it was this random number one contender battle royal. And it just so happened that, like, he's got injured right at the start, rolled under the bottom rope. I think Flair, of all people, run it, and then comes in at the end, chucks him out. And I remember screaming at the TV, going, that's not fair, that's not fair. I'd to the stage, like, my mom was like, what's happened? What's the matter? It's like, oh, he's cheated to win. And she's like, oh, okay, it's there. I just walked out. So I remember just being angry at that. And I also loved, I was a huge fan of MAGA as well. I just thought he was just fantastic, just going on an absolute tear at that time. That's when he was like his IC champion. And like some of his matches, like against Jeff Hardy, and especially the one against Cena at the Rumble, mm-hmm. It's like, that's one of my favorite matches of all time. It's absolutely brilliant.
Were you able to get to any live shows around about that time? Because I know around about that time, the loop was in Scotland anyway, was Umaga John Cena for a minute. Anyway,
I remember we went to a live event with my dad when I was younger, Brayhead. I remember Umaga being on it, but I honestly can't remember who he faced. The two things I remember from that event was Umaga beat somebody up and William Regal came out and cut a promo basically calling Scotland crap. someone came out and battered him, and I just remember just booing Regal because it was one of these like, oh, I used to have friends that lived here, but they all live in England now because England's so much better. And I was just this wee guy going like, oh, you can't say that, what are you doing? I mean, some baby face came in and battered him. I honestly can't remember who it was. But yeah, it was looking back, it's weird how like the cliches definitely work. All of your standards when you're a wee kid. Oh, it worked on me. It obviously works.
Oh, yeah. And it's the same other way around. Like, if you see an English wrestler or that and you shout Scotland, it's the best feeling in the world.
There's a wee bit about it. Yeah, it's quite nice.
I'm going to check who I saw on that tour because I've a very same memories of that. And for some reason, I think it's D'Lo Brown I saw.
I honestly can't remember.
I'm going to do this live because I'm curious. Because I went to those tours about the same time, but obviously in Aberdeen, so it was little bit different. But much as such the same tours, probably.
Presumably, yeah.
But, you know, professional here, I'm just going to just go on thecagematch.com and find out.
Go for it.
That's the sort of stuff. Like, vocal interview you and ask about all sorts of things, but here I am just going, right, what was the card for your first show? Right, let's see, 2008-ish.
Around that time, yeah.
Okay, so it's probably a Raw one, as you said, because
there was Regal and Umaga.
So
yeah,
we've got 2007, Jeff Hardy and Triple H versus Randy Orton and Umaga.
I think it might have been a tag match, so it's probably that one.
Or 2006, DX and John Cena against Rated RKO and Umaga.
It wasn't DX because I got into DX when it was the DX revival because I was a kid. I remember it wasn't DX, so it must have been the other one.
Oh, what a card then? Balls Mahoney versus The Miz. Nitsky is super crazy.
I genuinely have no memory of that at all. I'm sure it was that's the case, but those are the only two bits for whatever reason I can remember.
Cody Rhodes, Carlito, Lansky de Murdoch versus Kendrick in London, Mr. Kennedy and Hardcore Holly. Oh, that is.
Some names in there.
To be honest, nowadays, if I look back on that, I would have really loved that.
If I was to go and watch that now, I'd be delighted.
Anyway, so back to your own journey. So from that point onwards, you're still young now in 2024, if you're saying you're about 8 or 9, around about 2006 or so. When was the kind of transition from watching it to wanting to be a wrestler?
I ended up having a bit of a break from being a wrestling fan sort of during high school and stuff like that, just because I just kind of fell out of it and stuff like that during that time. And it was just after I went to uni in college and stuff, when I sort of watching, and that was the time where it was the real wrestling YouTube like peak. So it was like you're being the elites, your what culture's just starting to come up, all that sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. So I got back into it via the YouTube. And I actually had no knowledge of indie wrestling before that. I didn't even know it was a thing. I knew WWE, that was it, and TNA. But I just knew that was it. So then I started watching. It was like Being the Elite and all that. And thought like, oh, okay, this is pretty good. And I remember my first ever indie show, ironically happened to be, is WCPW in Edinburgh. And it was Hendry Mania, of all things, with my first ever indie show. And it was great. It's great fun because I remember the main event was Joe and Martin Kirby and ended up fighting all around the stand. And it was brilliant. It was really, really good. And I thought, oh, that was fun. I'm going to go and see if there's any more indie wrestling in Scotland. I have no idea what there is. And that's how I found it was ICW at the time. Mm-hmm. So I remember me and my mate went through. It was like, we'll go and give it a go, see what it's like. If might not come through. And it was just before one of the Hydro shows, because it was on that show they officially confirmed it was going to be Joe Coffey versus BT Gunn for the title. I think it was the second or the third Hydro show? I can't honestly remember. But it was a brilliant show because that was when Kaylee Ray won the women's title and all that sort of stuff. And it was brilliant. And I watched that And it was, I thought, okay, well, I'm coming to all of these shows now. This is fantastic. So I was a big fan for all that sort of time. I've been just watched for a while like that. And every so often I've come back from a show going, oh man, that looks amazing. I really want to do that. That looks like so much fun. And I would just keep finding reasons to put it off. And because I'm in Edinburgh and there was no schools in Edinburgh or anything like that. So I thought, it's in Glasgow. It's too far away, which I know is not, but it was just me finding an excuse not to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was one of those, it was just some random night and I'm on my computer and I've had a couple beers and it pops up on my YouTube, or Joe Hendry is opening a wrestling school in Edinburgh. And I don't know if it's the fact I'd had a drink and I thought, go on then, I'll sign up for it. And then it's one of them, I thought, what have I done? Oh dear. That's gonna be a mistake. I was like, I've paid for it now. I guess I better go along. And I went along and I just fell in love with it. It was amazing.
Is when you speak about the travel, like Edinburgh to Glasgow, when you get there, I don't know if Ryan Richards was in the same like initial class.
We started on the same day. It was me and him. And
so when you're looking at him and he's going, oh, I've traveled like 6 hours to get down here, and you're like,
oh no. I'm like, oh no.
I was put off because it was an hour and I just came here on a whim.
Basically. Yeah, basically. Because like he was there because I was in the second intake of school, which is now obviously Disco Academy. So like the first intake was like your Rob Stowe's, Judas, all that sort of stuff. And then the second intake was me, Ryan Richards, Manival, and a couple others. So yeah, it's weird to see like how a few of us have like stuck it out and sort of got quite far together. But it was also one of those things as well. I was like, because my timing's amazing. I started my first ever training session was January 2020. So I've done just enough to get me hooked. And then it was like, oh, okay, we're just stopping. It's like, oh.
I can't believe it's still 4 years ago, but it feels like it was either last week or a million years ago. It's such a weird thing. So names you mentioned, of course, they're all active and doing incredibly well. So we'll definitely touch upon most, if not all of them, through yourself and through Monstrum's career as well. So we'll definitely touch upon those. But when it came to starting, because you're a bigger guy, was there wrestlers that you kind of looked to think before you started training, thinking, right, okay, this guy can do this. Maybe it's something I could do as well. Was there anyone that you could look back to?
Yeah, there's quite a few, but the big one was Samoa Joe. I always sort of watched his and I really wanted to do his style and stuff like that. And just the way he just battered folk was amazing. And just the way he flung himself about it. And I thought, I was quite a bit like, I don't know, if this hurts, okay, but I just kind of got to go for it. It's one of those things. It's like a lot of the stuff I learned, especially in the first few weeks of wrestling, was like, I'm just going to fall on my face for 6 weeks until I hit this right. Then when I stop falling on my face, I know I can do it. It's fine.
Did you have like a background in any sports beforehand? I'm assuming for your build, rugby is probably somewhere you've done in the past.
I played rugby all through high school. Yeah. Played rugby at a highly decent level, sort of went through the pathway system and stuff like that. So yeah, I played a lot of rugby, played a bit of football. I played sport all the time. I've always just been fairly athletic and stuff like that. But rugby was my big one. Yeah.
Yeah. So you're not afraid, like you said, you're falling on your face. That's something that just comes with the territory, especially rugby. So
100%. Yeah.
Fear was not part of the equation then when you started. It was more a case of just trying to learn the pieces.
Yeah. Fear wasn't an issue. I think stupidity was quite a factor. But it was one of those. I just kind of went, well, let's just see what happens if I try this. And I was like, oh, okay, that hurt. How does that not hurt anymore? You got to do this. Okay, try it again and just keep doing it till I got it right. Even if it meant falling on your face 50 times.
So it would have been Joe that would have been part of the training staff. Dave as well. Dave Conrad would have been there about as well. Is there anyone through things like seminars and that particularly spoke to you directly, kind of, that was perfect for what you were planning to do or wanting to do?
Yeah, the big one I remember is remember me, Rob Stowe, and Skinner travel down to Nottingham to do an Axel Tuchel tournament with the former Alexander Wolf in WWE. It was not long after he just got released down at Wrestle Carnival. And there's a few of us doing it, and he's having us, he's sort of talking through some different psychology and stuff like that. And the big one I remember was sort of we were doing things, circling, locking ups, stuff like that, just showing different examples. I remember he pulled me aside, he was like, "Why are you circling?" I said, "I don't know, that's just what you do." He's like, "The big guy, claim the center of the ring, be big." I was like, "Oh yeah. Yeah, why would it's fair enough if it's a fast speed guy go like that. Why am I going like that? That doesn't make any sense at all." So I think he sort of passed on a lot of stuff. I think there's some stuff that he was there when obviously Walter was being trained. A lot of stuff that Walter was told as a bigger guy coming up, do this, do that. So he passed on quite a lot of stuff like that, which was really useful. And we've done one fairly recently as well, disco with Moose as well, another giant of a man. However big you think he is, he's bigger. Honestly, he's huge. So I asked a lot of sort of big guy stuff from him, and that he passed on quite a lot of really useful advice, and a lot of that main event psychology was really, really useful.
It's incredible when you mentioned the size of Moose being bigger than you think. It's I remember when I went to a show and I met Chavo Guerrero, and he's always been on TV as a small guy. You know, he's a cruiserweight. He's one of the smaller guys, and then you meet him and he's just humongous. You're like, oh
Oh
my
yeah.
God, if you're considered small,
Yeah,
how
I
big is
know.
everyone else? Kind of
Oh,
thing.
I've sort of noticed that. If you notice, like these guys from like TV and stuff, you've always seen us. You've seen they're a certain height. They're either a lot taller than you think they are, or there's one or two that I thought were quite a bit shorter than they were meant to be. But I don't know if I'm just a bit of a different scale for that as well.
Yeah, I suppose. Well, when what were you? 6 foot, six over six, three.
I'm 6'4".
Oh, not bad for
Yeah,
a
so
guess.
there you go. There you go. There you go.
But okay, so you're a bit tall.
Yeah.
But no, that claim in the middle of the ring, that's a fascinating. It's like it's one of those things. It's so logistical. It's so like full of logic that it's just one of those moments where someone says it to you, you go,
Yeah,
"Why
of
haven't I
course.
been doing that?" So
Yeah.
from that point onwards, was it you mentioned Joe being an inspiration, Samoa Joe. Lots of Joes nowadays in wrestling.
Yes, hundreds.
But when you heard that nugget of information, was that a jumping off point for other people like a Vader or
Yeah.
a Abyss or something like that you kind of moved
Oh,
towards?
there's so much, especially it wasn't originally, but I'd say right now, as my character, the person I've taken the most from watching is Vader. There's so much that I have moves I've named after him and stuff like that. He's so underrated as a wrestler. I mean, everyone talks about how good he was in Japan and stuff like that, but if you actually watch him and watch his interactions with the crowd and stuff like that, people were terrified of him, like legitimately. So I actually, when I started more of this more big man style, I watched quite a lot of sort of that Japan style. So I took a lot from like Stan Hansen, Bruiser Brody, those types as well. These giant sort of wild men who just go in and just terrify people. And it's like, because see folk, they're not running away like, oh, he's coming after me. They're running like, oh no, like I need to get out of here sort of thing. Genuine terrified running. And it's incredible to watch. And it's their psychology and things like that is really, really good.
I think people are starting because of his recent passing, people are going back through the archives and seeing Sid matches and seeing
Oh,
how
yeah.
his interaction and I think I was just too young to and I missed Sid.
So did that. Yeah.
I went back and I've got VHS tapes with matches on, but I wasn't there for Sid
Yeah.
and his run and going back and seeing these clips and he's a law unto himself. It's incredible to watch
Oh,
when it
yeah.
comes down to it. You mentioned a road trip there with including Ian Skinner. Conveniently enough, Ian Skinner has sent in a question which I think is appropriate. It's just put, what's Charlie Doug's best car story?
Yeah, I've got a few. Nothing's too wild has happened particularly. The one that springs to mind was the first ever Soft Pro show. So, and it was just I don't know if you've ever watched Opera. It's a fantastic product, but it's a bit Wild West, especially on the first one, because they were still trying to figure it all out. So the first show, the car down, is I'm driving. It's me, Skinner, Leighton Buzzard, and Manival. So we're obviously heading down to Manchester, get there, not a problem. Well, that's fine. The show's massively overrunning. I mean, it started late. And then it's doing all this sort of thing, going through. And then during the interval, there was a, I believe there was a problem with the sound system. So it's like a 40-minute interval. And we're like, and then we, even the rest of the show, and like the main event started about 12:30 at night. And it was a four-way main event. It had like Warhorse and stuff in it. Warhorse and Joseph Connors. And like, oh my God. So we left just before that because we had to. We had a 4-hour drive up the road, so we had to go. And it was just not. And then we're driving up the road halfway, and the motorway shuts, just crash further up, and we're sat there for about an hour going, like, how have we got ourselves in this situation? It's like 3 a.m. This is ridiculous. So it took us like 6 hours to get home, and sort of Manival lives a bit further up, close to sort of Fife area. So I sort of dropped him at his car, and he basically drove home and didn't get any sleep because he had not long had a baby. So it's one of them, it was like, you can go down, but tomorrow morning you're in charge. And he got home basically at Fife, went, there you go. yeah. But it was just one of those, it was just everything that could have gone wrong on the way home went wrong.
I know, I mean hindsight's wonderful, but if you knew that was going to happen, you would have just stayed and watched the rest of the show and then
of course but yeah, it's
but no, that trade-off as a new father, I know that one very well. You can go, but you're in charge when you come back. So, that's okay. It's the same with staying up to watch 4 hours of wrestling downstairs on pay-per-view, and then get up. I've got no excuse to be annoyed 2 hours later when the boy wakes up and I'm like, I brought this on myself, didn't I? So I'm just gonna have to
consequences of my own actions here.
I know. It's just gotta take it off with the smooth and all, etc. etc. But we do have another question from Ian, but I will throw that in later. Because we're gonna back to wrestling.
Yeah.
Which is your debut. Mm-hmm. So it's Big Chez making
his debut. Time, yes.
It was I've got a note down here as a source event. It was
it actually wasn't. It was down, that was my second show, was a source event.
It was a carnival or?
No, it was the BWR. I made my debut. I went down with Joe. It was a fairly last minute thing. He was doing the show and managed to get me a spot. So it was a battle royal. So it was me, Reese and Rogan, the Crash Boat, Semtex, Dara, Diablo, Jimmy, McGilly, I think, and someone else whose name I can't remember. But he does like the upside blood cross on his thing, big balls, and really, really nice. I feel bad for
Tomby. That seems
No, it wasn't Tomby. I know Tomby. It wasn't Tomby. Anyway, so like. Yeah, it was down in Grimsby for that one. So me and Joe drove down for that, and that was really good, because one of those, it was we're driving so late, we arrived fairly late, and it was one of those, battle royal, you're on first, go and get changed, you're on first, you've got like 20 minutes to plan. I'm like, and I deliberately didn't tell anyone it was my debut, because I just had my head off. Oh, you think it's a debut, just this random guy. I remember walking through, I'm trying to be big bruise and heel and all that sort of stuff. And I've looked back and you can just see terror in my eyes. And I'm like, what am I doing here? It's unbelievable. And this, I remember two or three steps from the stage down to the floor. And I remember all I could think was, don't fall, don't fall, don't fall. And then I was in the ring, as obviously all kicked off. And I'm like, just doing away, and there's so many times you see me, I'm just looking around going, oh my God, what am I doing here?
Because I mean, the names you mentioned, they're all big beefy boys as well.
Oh yeah,
So not only are you kind of thrown in the deep end, but it's not even like you're thrown in with a small guy that you can kind of like stand in the middle and puff out your chest and do all big moves too. It's a bunch of big dudes that you're in with as well. Yeah. So you kind of have to try and stand out. Did you feel ready, or do you handle pressure as in sink or swim, kind of just like, this is what you're doing?
I was very much a dive in for, I felt ready and things like that. And to be fair to every single one of those guys, they're all brand new, nice as anything, helped get me through it and all that sort of stuff, especially sort of Dara Diablo and stuff like that. He basically helped me put my stuff in, because especially when it comes to Battle Royale, I didn't know what I was doing. I just kind of went, okay, let's do it, and sort of worked my stuff. And then I remember telling them after, it was like, hey, by the way, that was my debut. And virtually all of them were like, seriously? No, you've done great. That's fantastic. Yeah, well done, man. It's one of those, they were very surprised it was my debut, because for a while I generally performed and stuff like that. But it was one of those, it was like, oh my God, it was, I don't really get too much of that now, but I just remember that first from being like, okay, this is real now. You've done all this practicing, all this training, this is real now.
I think what I've learned, because I've spoken to a few of Joe's boys now, yourself, Rob, Judas, Manival, Major Matt Wolf as well,
Matt Hughes, another man who started the same day as me, Major Matt.
It really seems to be, I've learned that Joe wouldn't put anyone in a position if he doesn't think they're ready, kind of thing.
Yeah.
All of the guys that have come out of that school are just like show ready first time without they look, even though, like you're saying, eyes are full of terror.
Yeah.
You at least know to handle yourself and to make it, at least you look like you know what you're doing, whether your brain's functioning or not in that moment in time. Totally. So he's done well.
I think a factor of that as well was, especially at the start of the school, we weren't associated with a company at all. We were just ourselves. Mm-hmm. So you'll find with a lot of companies, a lot of schools and stuff that are associated with companies, they're able to get their guys on shows earlier, even if it's starting on stuff like Gala Days or like getting squashed in a pre-show match or something like that. That's how a lot of guys can sort of build you up a bit. We didn't have that luxury, unfortunately. We had to basically rely on Joe calling in favors to get us a spot places for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And he wasn't willing to stick his neck out if he knew we weren't going to, you know, prove him right, if you know what I mean.
Because his reputation that you're exactly. You're also it's hanging on as well, which is
totally
another high pressure thing to have going. If you do it wrong, it's Joe that is going to blow back on.
Yeah, because it is one of them. If he puts his neck on the line saying like, hey, can you give one of my guys a chance, and we stink up the joint, well, that's everyone else's chances of that company knackered. Yeah, exactly.
But on the most part, I don't think I've seen a bad one coming out of that school yet. So that's he's clearly doing something right and building the right team and all that kind of stuff at this school. Because I know Emerson Jane's involved and Skinner was there for a bit. And
we've had different structures in coaches. Like Skinner was a trainer for a bit before he moved down south. DCT trained with us for a while before he moved to Australia. He was a big help, and now we've got stuff like Emerson and Joe and all that. And Aspen as well, sort of big, huge helps. It's one of those. I've been incredibly blessed to have been trained by incredibly good people. I've been really lucky in that regard.
Yeah, I mean, what was that, 34 minutes, people? If you want an Aspen shout, that was the timer on there. It wasn't even me, did it? So let's talk about Monstrum for a moment then.
Mm-hmm.
How did you become introduced to Monstrum? Where was the meeting point? How did this become?
So I remember when I first started trying, I wanted to sort of basically be a big guy in a singlet. I wanted to sort of be a big guy who's athletic and cool and all that sort of stuff. It wasn't clicking. There was just something that wasn't there. And then the idea of Monstrum and the concept of introducing him came across, and I was initially like, oh, do I want to deal with this guy? What's happening here? But eventually I sort of as I looked more into it, I got to understand it, him and it as an entity more. And that's when that sort of came across, and sort of looking around different companies, I was able to see there's a gap in that market. There isn't a big monster, and like a big mask monster really across British wrestling. There's loads of guys in masks, loads of luchadors, there's big guys, but there's not a big mask guy. There's not a Kane, there's not an Abyss around the scene. And that was a gap in the market I could definitely see.
Because, I mean, you came in just about a year after Crusher Craig retired, and I think for my money, that is the kind of big guy that had been missing from Scottish wrestling for a long time. Just a big, scary dude that just throws you. And here's where Monstrum steps in. So is Monstrum kind of, like, say, you talk about it as an entity? Is it just a side of your brain that you don't like letting out, that kind of has to come out?
Well, it's not one of them. No one likes letting out that weird thing, but it's generally not up to me. It just kind of does what it wants. I'm just kind of what happens when it's not busy, when it doesn't want to be around. So it is this sort of force, this concept that sort of takes over every now and then. So he's in charge, I'm just along for a ride at that point.
You're the passenger. He's the dark passenger and takes over driving every so often. So I was looking through the matches. You seem to be kind of building. You built your time up, and Monstrum built his time up through community pro wrestling initially. Because, like you're saying, at that point, Joe's School wasn't affiliated to any particular promotion. So a lot of you guys end up going through places that Joe was going. But community pro seemed to be a place where you guys kind of sink your teeth into it and forge a little bit of momentum and what have you. Mm-hmm. Which spawned quite a lot of, everyone wanted a piece of Monstrum. Everyone wanted Monstrum on their side, which absolutely makes sense. But the guy that seemed to tame yourself and the monster was Mr. Manival. So how did you said you were in the same class? Of course, Manival wasn't there to be a wrestler. That wasn't his path he wanted to take. He wanted to learn, but not be a wrestler. Was that something that you guys discussed? Was there always kind of a thought where he would be kind of the, I don't want to say this as detriment, but the scrawny guy next to, you want to be the Whippleman, you know, to the monster. Was that always the thought?
Yeah, it was actually Joe's idea originally to put us together. Because he basically like, look, we've got this big guy, and we're training a big guy and we're training a manager. It's logically put them together. It makes sense. And then once me and Manival were always sort of friends anyway, so once we knew this was a thing, we were able to really sink our teeth into this, really do stuff together, and it sort of clicked instantly. It worked really well. It's especially, I find, with like when Monstrum's there and he's just that little sort of almost Nosferatu looking over the shoulder, I just think it's a great image. It really, really works. I think it just
it's proper. It's old school. Because remember back in the days, so you would have your Whippleman, like your your cornets even. They would have these just monsters behind them, and makes everyone look bigger because he's smaller as well. Which is fascinating. So I'm gonna ask you see what you remember. What Monstrum let in on some of the matches that you were part of, and see if we can get a little bit of info. I mean, there's obviously matches that you were part of as well.
I was along for the soft pro stuff with myself, thankfully, and even the Monstrum matches. Monstrum was in control. I was along for the ride, so I can tell you what was generally he was thinking.
So, being the first match that just piqued my interest as I was going through there was against Big Ross Hauser, the community pro, which seems like it's probably one of those matches where you look back and go, that was not pretty in the slightest. That was terrifyingly ugly, but look at it. You know, it's like one of those two big dudes battering the living, you know what, out of each other.
Yeah.
Was that your first kind of maybe not so much wake up call, but was that your first proper like hard match. Like just everything was stiff.
That was definitely Monstrum's first back like big man match, and it was great fun. I just remember it's like every time, and if we still get it today in community pro wrestling, every time me and Ross look at each other, the crowd goes, "Oh, here we go." Every time, regardless, that was the only singles match we've had, but we faced each other in tags and crossed over in rumbles and things like that. Every time me and Ross come together, the crowd loves it, and we just beat the ever loving crap of each other. There is nothing, like I said, it's not pretty. It's just bang, 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 and so much fun. I love that big man, just immovable object, unstoppable force, just boom, just going for each other.
That's your rugby days coming back.
Yeah, exactly. Just nostalgia. Just
laying into each other. But no, you need that on a show. I mean, it's well and good being able to do like the old flip. I say flip the doodles, not like I don't love watching flips and but you need that kind of variety on a show, and seeing two big lads just smash each other
I love watching it as well, even when I'm not involved. Watching two big guys just bar each other, it's so good.
I mean, one of the best matches 1 year at WrestleMania was Goldberg Lesnar, and it was what, 5 minutes?
Yeah, perfect.
Because they just two ran big guys each other.
Ran at each other, aye. It's like you think it's all the flippy match. That match is remembered. It's so good.
I know it's moments, isn't it? Wrestling. That's totally. the key word that WWE tried to push for years, and then when you sit down and think about it, you go, yeah, I don't remember a lot of matches, but I remember a lot of moments when it comes
exactly.
to
wrestling. Exactly.
So yeah, I mean that was the kind of flip. You had Martin McAllister like the show previous, and that's mm-hmm. a totally different dynamic.
Yeah.
In there, but like I was saying, people are all what a piece of Monstrum. So you were he was tapped up by James Erdos. He was tapped mm-hmm. up by Thatcher Wright. I mean Thatcher was able to get into the ears of both sides of you, Charles Douglas and Monstrum, so I don't know what he's doing, but Thatcher's got the power that maybe we're all a bit terrified to find out about. And of course, Rob Stowe as well, the good times with that in mind. So the good times is of course, for Discovery, primarily mm-hmm. Discovery. Rob, another one that, sorry, did you say he was in your class or was he the class
before? He was the class before.
So how did that relationship blossom then, yourself and Rob? Was it just again, through these classes, striking up
through classes, traveling. Me and Rob, I'm traveling every day. I remember the car to training was pretty much every week was me, Rob, and Skinner. So we were able to sort of bounce ideas off each other quite a lot there and stuff like that. But I know we're in Discovery because he was in Discovery before I was, because he initially came in with Manival as part of the thing with Joe and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And obviously they turned on Joe, so they needed some reinforcements, because obviously Joe is still a big guy, so you need some reinforcements there, and that's how we came in together like that. And then unfortunately we got distracted from Joe by a certain tag team which, you know, we've had very differences with,
but it seems to be, from what we've discussed already, those must be some of the most fun matches that you can look back on and think, my God, that was just an absolute riot. Of course, good times and Skull Brawl. Of Lost Boy Aspen's already got his mention. Here's Caleb next. Caleb's part of Skull Brawl. And you guys just, it's just one of those things where, again, talking about variety, you've got the Discovery prides itself on having like wrestling matches. They're having some pure matches, some high flying action. And then there's you guys who just go in, caution to the wind, just throw fists and yourselves at each other. As far as those kind of matches go, is that just like, not even, I don't want to say a night off for you, but it's just one of those where you just look at it and go, yeah, we're gonna have fun tonight,
definitely one of those, yeah, this is gonna be good. You've just got that feeling of like, yeah, this is gonna be good, going into it and just laying each other. It's like, I think the reason why Discovery is so good is it does have that variety, have that so many shows, because you've got guys like ourselves who's battering absolute loving Jesus out of each other. And then you've got sort of incredible technical wrestling with like Skinner and stuff like that. And then you've got sort of the high flying of like Judas and Slater. But it's also a case as well, you need to know what your role is on a card. It's like, if you're on a card with Leon Slater, are you going to do more impressive flippy stuff than him? No. So why compare yourself? What are you going to do when you're, what are you going to do better than anyone else on that card? And that's what you need to make sure your main role is.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I felt that. I've only been to one Discovery show, and it was the one in April. Mm-hmm. And I got to see, it was yourselves against Skull Brawl in a no DQ match for the tag titles. What an introduction to Monstrum, because I've never seen him wrestle like in person before, or never seen the monster wrestle in person. Yeah. And it's, that was exactly what was needed in that moment, was just a big brawl between two teams that have had their differences, they've had their brawls, they've had their street fights and all that kind of stuff. And it was just a hell of a lot of fun. So, I mean, moving forward in Discovery, we're going to jump forward and jump back here. Monstrum was teaming with Rob Stowe, Judas Gray, going in with three pretty big names.
Yeah.
Especially on the 14th of July when it happened, because Joe Hendry was just going viral at that point. He was in NXT. Elijah, aka Elias, still pretty big name coming out of WWE. Yeah. Adam Maxted as well, quite a heavy name in the UK scene from Love Island, and he's going to be part of WOS Wrestling by the time this goes out. I think it's actually going to be tomorrow as this goes out that taping's taken.
Nice one.
Is there ever, when you stand there, and I know that the brain is kind of flickering between the terrifying monster and yourself as going along with the ride, but is there a moment where you stand there looking across and seeing those three opponents where you go, my God, I've been doing this for what, 2 years? How am I in this position? Or, oh my God, I hope I don't absolutely screw this up.
Yeah, there's definitely elements of that, 100%. The only thing, only one of them it weirdly doesn't apply to is Joe, because he trained me and done so much for I, as well as he's doing, it's fantastic. He's blowing up and nailing it in NXT. I don't see him as this big superstar Joe. I see him as my coach Joe, mm-hmm. which is sort of very different, and it's almost a bit weird. But I distinctly remember in this match the point where Elias is doing the old school and he's on the top rope and he's got me in a wrist lock, and he's shouting, "Who wants to walk with Elias?" And I'm looking up going, oh my God, what, how am I in this situation? It's one of them. I'm like, what's happening here? It's so weird. And then he came down and punched me in the shoulder, which kind of snapped me back to reality. It was just a bit surreal, especially with that. I mean, it's like the likes of like Maxted, who's such a big name and stuff as well, and just working these guys. Like I say, I've really only been wrestling just over 18 months, 2 years, basically post-COVID. Mm-hmm. I shouldn't be in the position I'm in, but I am, and it's fantastic. So, yeah.
But it goes back to, again, all you guys, for at least for the first couple of years of your career, your work is reflected on Joe, and Joe has to, because he opened the doors for you to do it, and it's your job to kind of keep those doors open at the same time. So the fact that you've packed in, I mean, Cage Match only says you've had 32 matches, but we've already established that there's a few missing, quite a few missing. But even then, seeing the positions you've been put in through Solve Pro, which is probably going to be my next subject here, but Discovery and Community Pro, you've been put into some high pressure situations, and you're still going, so clearly you're doing something right in that respect.
It's one of the high pressure situations, and like I remember, especially after all of these situations, I come back thinking, was that all right? I don't know. It's one of those, I'm like, have I mucked this up? Is this okay? But I'm still going, so I guess it's all right.
But you mentioned like when you're against Joe, it's just you're against Coach Joe. But what was it like actually getting into the ring with him one-on-one? I think it was Attitude Pro, going for Wishaw.
Yes,
you got in with him, mm-hmm. actually one-on-one. Was that everything were you able to kind of put everything into practice that he's taught you? What was your, how was that for you?
Yeah, that was almost like an ultimate test sort of thing, a bit, because it's like, I've been doing really well at community and Attitude Pro and stuff like that. And there was a position where I got into the position where I could face someone like Joe. And I was like, okay, he's like, he's seen me at training, he's seen me do all this. Now let's see if you can actually do it. Let's see if we can actually do it. And he was really good in that match. He sort of let me almost as always treated the match as almost like a training exercise, if you know what I mean. It's like, let's test what I've been teaching you over the last few years and let's see if you can really do it. And I think we've done really well. It was really good. And I was delighted with it, apart from the fact that he beat me. But, you know, that was a bit annoying. But, you know, I'll get him next time.
Absolutely. So then, soft pro then. So this is when the duplicity of Monstrum and Charles Douglas kind of collides for a moment, where 1 minute it'll be one side and the next minute something will snap and you'll end up being the terrifying masked monster to destroy people. Totally. Like you mentioned, soft pro is I don't want to say what do I not want to say? Unorganized. I don't want to say unorganized. That's definitely not the case, but it is mad.
It's insane. It's nuts. But in the best possible way. It's mental. It's like their production value and things like that is second to none. It's fantastic. If you ever make it down to a live show, you'll see that the setting they've got and the video packages and all that, it's genuine. The production second to none. It's fantastic. And they put on some of the best matches like I've ever seen. Like, one of the best matches I've ever seen live was the four-way they done for the Commonwealth title, which was Ninja Mac, Leighton Buzzard, Leon Slater, and Man Like Derice. And it's just, I remember watching that match just thinking, like, what am I meant to do to compete with that? That was incredible. That was insane. There's nothing I can do if it can even come close. It was unbelievable. It's just that, because it's that new upstart promotion, they've got that raw excitement from a new promotion, and it's really good. And I think they can really go far if they keep on progressing like they're progressing. They could definitely be one of the next big promotions.
And you ended up dragged into the Les Battersby World Order and Butcher's Club.
Yeah, I
talked to Ryan about it, and of course Ryan's very straight laced and professional, and was absolutely furious that Les Battersby blindsided them. But you talked about Elijah looking up and seeing him and going, "Oh my God, what's happening?" Just the whole soft pro like saga of Les Battersby is just insane in wrestling. I don't understand how it started, and I'm still confused about the whole thing. And you were there.
I was not 100% sure how it started, and I was there. Yeah, it was just nuts. The whole thing was like a bit surreal, if you know what I mean. It's, where's this guy? And like, sort of getting ready beforehand and all that sort of stuff. And he's obviously a bit tentative. He doesn't know what's going to happen and stuff like that. And like, a few of the boys are sort of saying, "Oh no, it'll be fine. And like, obviously we're going to jump him, so I'm not speaking to him. So I'm just sort of waiting. And then the reception he got when he walked through, it was just nuts. It was unbelievable. And then obviously we were really pissed off he was there, because it's a wrestling show. He's not a wrestler. This is ridiculous. How is he getting that in front of us? So that's when we decided we're going to deal with this ourselves, because no one else is going to. And unfortunately it turned out that the LBWO then attacked us, which was completely unprovoked and unnecessary, and I don't understand it. And it weirdly ended up everywhere, because I was trying to help Mr. Wright, and he's been attacked, and he's sort of lying down. I turn round, I end up getting hit with 3D from the LBW, which is completely out of order and unnecessary. And then by the time I finally make it to my feet, he's headbutted me, and I'm hitting the ground. And it was absolutely mental. And if you look at the the pictures a lot from that first that got picked up by various news outlets. It's me midair about to fall over from a headbutt. It's all of me like that. And that was insane. That's the first time I'd sort of really seen myself in like these national papers. And like people who know me but don't know wrestling, like saw that stuff. And it was just like, it was nuts. It really was nuts.
And again, I've watched the shows, unfortunately, but I've seen like the clips and stuff like that, and then the blue Les Barsby World Order appeared, and
that was the show. I wasn't there, unfortunately. That was the show after. Yeah.
Oh, that's a shame. Big strong man, big strong blue man himself. No, it's Soft Pro is one of those fever dream promotions. So if people are wanting that kind of thing, just go see it because it's mad.
Because I remember we had because that was the first show, and the second show we had the Coronation Street fight, and that was just nuts. I like, we're getting battered with a tray with a Gail Platt calendar on it, and it's Danny's coming out and throwing pigeons at us and stuff like that, and it's like, this is insane, what's happening here? I don't really understand. And then the whole Butcher Club stuff happened at the end, and it was like, I think I'm part of, this is insane, and I think I'm part of history here, but I honestly don't know, because this is so surreal as it happens.
I feel like when it comes to the surreality of it, it's probably as close as England may have got recently to way back when with the Kelvin Brawl stuff with Greg Hemphill, Rav Florence, and all that kind of stuff.
Probably at least the Manchester equivalent of that. Yeah, definitely.
Just the absolute madcapness of it. Right, so I've got more questions about Monstrum in general, but I want to ask about North as well, because that's another very big promotion to be part of.
Oh, yeah.
North's one of those promotions right now that are just going absolutely insane. You're part of Slam Fest, and it was I've got noted down here as a Battle Royal. When I'm looking down the names in it, I'm like, oh my God, that is quite a list from that. From your up here, your Caleb Valhalla's to yourself, and Liam Slater's in there, Rory Coyle, Veda Scott. It's quite a packed rumble itself. Yeah. So
it's hugely stacked.
It was like getting in there at North, because their fans are just much like Soft Rabbit. Their fans are rabbit. They want to see wrestling.
Oh, it's North again up there. That's going to be, if it probably is already, the next big promotion in the UK, because the quality of show, and again with their production value, it's second to none. I think that seems to be the big thing. If you've got that good production and you can attract these great wrestlers, it's really helps the show. And like, their stuff is second to none. The guys they've got on their roster is insane. Like, the quality is unbelievable. And like, I was really lucky to be involved, and I sort of really enjoyed it. I even got to get eliminate Caleb, which was, it's always fun. Yet another place we've clashed, and I'm sure it won't be the last place we've mentioned, but we've clashed.
No, it's definitely not. So before I get onto that, I want to talk about Monstrum more, about the mask. I want to talk about the kind of, because it started off with kind of like a black kind of balaclava kind of thing with the mask over the top, and then when I saw the monster once again very recently at Battle of the Nations WrestleZone, there you go, an hour for those taking track. it evolved since I last seen it to that more of like a skin mask.
And that was the debut of that mask, to be fair.
That is a haunting mask to look at. So which side of the brain's idea was that, and whose skin?
That was all him. I think that it's been a while since I've been out as Charles, so I have a feeling that's his way of taking more control over my brain, I guess. Yeah, I think that's his way of taking more control and more just that tighter grip on the brain, unfortunately. And yeah, that was all him. And it's one of those, it's like, started there and it's spread. It was time. It was one of those, it needed to be more.
That was kind of with that mask, that was kind of the transformation's complete when show day begins. That's it. Charles Douglas has disappeared. He's gone. It's Monstrum. But it was one of those shows where I didn't see an awful lot of the show because I had a 2-year-old I was chasing for his first ever show. But I saw that. I saw your debut because for months I had been paranoid about this countdown since Regal Rumble it happened the first time. Now, interestingly, when it happened at After the Anarchy, Mr. Charles Douglas was there.
Was he? Oh, that's convenient.
And then the countdown actually happened at Battle of Nations properly, and yeah, you came out, and just not often it happens at a WrestleZone show, but the place was silent watching this happen. And it's not one of those uninterested silences. It was fear.
Yeah.
And I suppose when you're watching all this happen through the mask, you must be sitting there going, yeah, this is what I want. This is the reaction I want. I want people to be scared. Like Vader, like Sid.
Yeah.
I want to be scared of this guy.
I do remember as Monstrum walked through and I was watching from behind his eyes and it was that silence. And I initially went, oh God, did he not understand? I mean, I walked a wee bit further and he looked around and he saw people's faces and I, oh no, this is good silence.
Mm-hmm.
This is what he wants. Yeah, and that reaction was bang on the money. Exactly what I was after.
I mean, I'm a grizzled vet on watching these shows now, and yeah, I was sitting there just in fear watching. Yeah. I mean, and I've seen Monstrum. I saw you at Discovery. I've seen you on the internet. I've seen you watching matches on the internet and all that kind of stuff. And even in that moment, I was there. I was believing. I was watching two of my favorites getting absolutely demolished by a terrifying monster with a skin mask that just like, even now I'm talking about it, I'm like getting goosebumps of that nice feeling. It's nice at your end. Yes. Feeling this.
Yeah.
but I'm scared to see where we're going to go, and I'm absolutely glad I won't be at Halloween Hijinks because I know something will happen over there. No, chaos will be my next one for WrestleZone. So I'm gonna have to just live vicariously through the internet and there see what happens from there.
Yeah.
But oh God, right. I'm gonna calm down for a moment because I'm getting all those feelings back again of fear, which doesn't happen at wrestling shows often. But nice feeling for it when you know that's how you're making people feel. If that's
it's 100% what I'm going for. Well, what he's going for. I'm just watching.
So looking into the future, and then we'll go back into the questions a little bit. Discovery Wrestling. So this seems to be this is where Monstrum's really is now. Of course, Community Pro will be in there as well, Attitude Pro, but Discovery is where Monstrum resides. They're going to Germany in November.
We are.
So at the moment you've wrestled in Scotland, you've wrestled in England. Will this be your first international going to Europe?
It will. It will
so
be my first.
Is that a bucket list thing that you
have? 100%. Getting the opportunity to wrestle abroad, wrestle in Germany, it's stuff of dreams. It's unbelievable. I'm so excited. It's one of those. Joe is very holds his cards close to his chest, tells need to know sort of stuff, especially when it comes to stuff like this. So I was told months ago, put that date aside. Wasn't told what for, didn't know what it was, all that sort of stuff. And I was like, okay, a Wednesday's pretty weird, but okay, I guess I will. And then you're sort of putting stuff, because we've got like a training sort of thing. So like, oh yeah, just by the way, that thing for 24th is getting the 24th anyway, it's getting announced soon. Just so you're aware. Okay, I wonder what it is. And then he announced it and I was like, oh my God. Oh my God, this is insane.
Like, considering the last time Discovery had a show on a Wednesday night, it was the Elite at the Corn Exchange and they sold out. And by all accounts from what I'm seeing so far, and again this has been recorded about 2 weeks before it goes out, but it looks like that it's gonna be a very quick sellout.
35 tickets are left.
that's they'll be gone by the time that
by the time this is released, they'll be away.
But that is incredible. It shows that not only the power of Discovery Wrestling, well, Joe Hendry especially, the power that he holds over wrestling right now. Because, I mean, for all accounts, we could be speaking right now and he'll be NXT champion.
He very well could be.
But also the power, the brand that Discovery Wrestling have built up through through Alan and Alex into Joe's reign as well as owner of the promotion. It's incredible work that everyone's put into make that possible.
Yeah.
And you're going to pick off some cool things.
One of the things I found, especially in Discovery right now, is like Joe having Joe Bot. We're standing sort of on the shoulders of what everything that Alan's done 100% is. We would not be even close to the position we were if it wasn't for the years and the years of hard work he's put in. So, yeah, definitely.
So, and of course, Halloween Disco is coming up as well, which seems perfect for Monstrum to be part of. And
ideal.
No doubt that you'll be part of Halloween hijinks as well, which again I'll have to watch from afar. And that day I'm taking off something off my bucket list, so I'm gonna have
fair. Yeah, fair enough.
But Les Mis, I'm gonna go see Les Mis.
Ah, there you go, that'll be good.
That's unfortunately I had to choose one or other. And everyone listening to this now are gonna listen and going, well, you chose the wrong one. But you know. Anyway. Back to the questions. We've got quite a few from familiar names that I'm going to bring up. We'll leave Ian's near the end because it's going to just hurt your brain. We'll start with Judas Gray. He's got on Twitter, do you want to make a bet?
No, I don't, because the last bet we made, I very much lost.
Oh, can you? Can you tell?
Basically, it was at training. We've made a bet ages and ages ago. Who's going to win a belt first? And it was, he won the open weight belt because I believed at the time he was not planned. He wasn't going to win it, but ended up winning it. So I was a bit like, oh, crap. So I kind of lost a bet and it was basically 10 chops at training. And then I was like, oh, I don't want him to chop me 10 times. Okay, I mean, one of those just happened to be five people at training. I was on my way and I was like, oh, Kim, what? Give two to everyone, it'll be fine. That'll be as bad. And then I turned up, and the people at training was Aspen, Bruiser Brad, Rob. I walked in, I'm like, I've made a huge mistake. And that is, I've never seen him so happy, and I hate it.
I know, happy Judas just kind of just, it, something about it just chills it's your wrong. Soul.
Yeah.
But, I haven't seen it. I don't think I've seen a happy Judas in real life because he just continues to throw stuff at me. The happiest I've ever seen him is when he orchestrated my wife throwing stuff at me during our last recording, which I was both furious and very proud of everyone involved.
I remember I spoke to him just after that and I was sort of, well, no, how'd it go? I mean, he just went, it went great. I sorted this. It was like, oh, okay, so that was clearly his plan the entire time.
Oh, I didn't know what to think, and then apparently Kelly was on the other side of the door waiting for me to do the intro, just so she could run in and throw it at me and then leave. And oh god,
he's an absolute nightmare.
He is, but he's bloody good. So unfortunately, we've just got to put up with it for a little bit because he's fantastic.
We're stuck with him regardless whether we want to be or not.
We did have a follow up question, which now makes sense. If I become a double champ before you win your first belt, how many chops?
None. I've learned from my mistakes.
I'm just waiting for if you do relent, he's just gonna get everyone he's been through with the pursuit and going down south and everything. Like, who's the hardest choppers?
I think it's still Aspen.
That does not shock me in the slightest.
No.
He's also asked DMG.
Of course he did.
Yeah.
Yeah. No.
Okay.
I am not.
Good. I'm not going to explain DMG. You know what it is. I know what it is. Believe it.
Unfortunately,
that.
Yeah.
How long was did you know Judas before he asked you?
I knew him a bit longer because I knew him before that was a thing.
All right.
So I was asked basically when, as soon as it became a thing. And it had explained to me, it was like, what are you on about? Why is this a thing? But it is.
It is. So people go through the archives episodes. I'm not.
Yes, I'm not. I'm not giving it any more attention than it deserves.
And he's also just put peaches. So is that a Bowser reference?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
Cool. There we go. We've got Liam Stewart, again, someone who I'm familiar with.
Yes,
he may have some shares in a chip van of some description. He's put rank every tag partner you've had, all 999,000 of them, from best to Erdos.
Yeah, it's a bit of a running gag that I've got lots of tag partners. It's, you know, but the reason why I tag them is because I tag with some of the best people. It's like, because I think it's like, there's me, Erdos, like Thatcher, Richards, Rob Stowe, Judas I recently tagged with. So let's put Judas at the bottom just for fun. Let's definitely do that. I think I put the rest, everyone else, on level pegging, but Judas is definitely lower.
Ah, the old Bobby Heenan theme music gag. That's
exactly, there you go.
Hulk Hogan's music theme being his second favourite. What's the first? The rest of them.
Everyone else is, yeah.
Wonderful. That's the brain. And the last question we do have on here is from Ian Skinner, and it is... Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games, or games, unlimited games, but no games?
I could have bet my house this was going to be a question.
Hang on, I misread it. It's, would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games, or games, unlimited games, but no games?
The bacon. Because if you try and understand this question, you never will. You just need to choose one.
I asked this question to Jasmine St. Clair recently.
What was her reaction out of genuine curiosity?
I think she went for bacon. She was a good sport about it. I was terrified to ask her because she'd also brought up, like, I asked her what her plans were, what she wanted to do, any bucket list things. And her first one was like, I want to meet Donald Trump. And I was like, oh God. Oh no.
Okay, let's.
How's this going? Oh, bacon. How about bacon? But no, that's nobody's escaped that question recently. But it's not still not as bad as asking Scotty to Hottie about his favorite dinosaur. That's podcast. Anyway, looking ahead then, so we talked about discovering Germany, we've talked about whatever shenanigans Monstrum will get up to up in the northeast. Is there any immediate places that you'd like to try and pick off that list, or opponents? I'm seeing in my mind's eye here something with you and Damo somewhere down the line.
There's so many people I'd love to wrestle down the line. Damo's definitely on the run. Will Cruz is big up on that list. I'd love to, and we've talked about him earlier. Leon is so good. I'm desperate to wrestle Leon. Darius Layton. I want to wrestle everyone. That's the thing. Mm-hmm. Absolutely everyone in different varieties of styles. I just want to wrestle as many people as I possibly can.
I know, it's a shame that Blue Canes kind of stopped. That would have been.
Yeah, I was on a show with Blue Cane. That was when, during, I think it's the first Les Battersby stuff. He was on that show, so that was insane.
There's plenty of things on the horizon. I'm looking forward to it. So I'm glad that we got a little bit. Oh no, I'm on the wrong notes here. I had tomorrow's notes, and I was like, you're in the Big A Rumble. I was like, no, you weren't. I'm looking at the wrong page on my notes here. So yeah, there's so many things that now that you've fully embraced Monstrum going forward when it comes to wrestling. I mean, Charles Douglas may appear here and there.
But it's going to be majority Monstrum, unfortunately, for me.
It's going to be a wild ride, I'm sure. So if you want to direct people to your social medias, to Monstrum's social medias, which no doubt you're in charge of. He doesn't get to do this.
He makes me run them, unfortunately. I just kind of have to do what I'm told.
Where are we going?
So, yeah, most best place to catch me is on Instagram, MonstrumPW. I'm also on Twitter as well, under the same thing, at MonstrumPW. Catch me anywhere there. I'll be honest, I'm on Instagram a lot more than I'm on Twitter. So I'm not very good at the socials, to be fair. I need to get better. So catch me there. Or you can catch me at any of the Discovery shows. any of the CPW shows, any of the APW shows, and you'll definitely catch me at WrestleZone as well.
That's a terrifying, haunting thought to end up with.
No escape.
But thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me. I'm fascinated about what you see and what happens going forward. And yeah, it's going to be a very chilling time up in the Northeast and everywhere else that Monstrum makes his appearance. But yeah, thank you very much.
Definitely will. I really appreciate you having me.